If you are, if you're not a detail person, you may not have noticed that the carpets are switched back. So the rectangular one's here and the circular one's there. I think that's my doing. Okay. Take two. You see, I have a tendency to wander, I think, a little bit too far for the camera and video people, so I think they put my cage back up here to keep me constrained. You know, we're, as people, you know, we respond to structure, and I'm no different, so I'm kind of happy to know what my box is. True confessions, I wasn't going to wander on this circle back here in the last couple weeks, and I didn't know how far I could go, so I'm grateful for these little details. In all seriousness, this morning, we're back into Isaiah. And we're going to be looking at the last three chapters of the prophetic burdens against the nations. And I'm thinking about just sort of globally. I was at a conference this past weekend with some of the pastors of the largest churches in New England, and we were talking a lot about God is doing New England. And I thought about, in lieu of Isaiah and everything that we're working through, like, what does God want for us? Like, not only what he expect of us, but what does he want for us as a community, as Groton Bible Chapel? And I was thinking that really, you know, God wants us to get a hold of this idea that he wants us in this community to be a kingdom-expanding, disciple-making, joy-filled body of servants of Jesus Christ. That's what he wants for us. That's really just another way of sort of recasting our vision to renew through equipping, enfolding, and encouraging. But he wants us to be just filled with himself and expanding his kingdom, making disciples, and so on and so forth. And that thematically, you see it in Isaiah. You'll note on your bulletin, the first three little bullets there, he wants us to be consumed and transformed by himself, to understand, and as he's referred to in Isaiah, the Holy One, that he is the prize, not heaven, not even fellowship with each other, but that he is the prize. He wants us to be consumed by that. And then thereby, because of that, that we live lives of holiness and service to him. Now, holiness is a kind of a Christian buzzword, but really just means a life that's set apart from the way other people live, with a different purpose, a different focus or vector, if you will. And then out of that comes this this idea of us being a redeeming people, that as we live and work and do our thing out there, that we are about bringing others into right relationship with himself because of these first two things. And so this is just something that exudes from us. And so this series, as Isaiah is dealing with Judah and God is dealing with us, is to help us move toward that, to continue to prepare us for that. God wants us to trust him first, and trust is a huge theme in the judgment oracles, because the source of our trust, when the source of our trust shifts in one direction or the other, our behaviors follow. Our lifestyle follows where the source of our trust is. So this morning, kind of thematically around all that, we're looking at this idea of the root and the result. And in this series, we believe that Jesus wants to get at the core of who we are, from our motivations on up, and shift our trust and our focus. And, you know, I love this book of the Old Testament. It's been so fun to study it and to just discover over and over again how relevant the things that Isaiah is writing to with his people, as we look at our own lives, as we look at our community, they're so relevant to where we are. However, we are at the last three chapters of the prophetic burdens to the nations. But lest you dismay, we are not done with the judgment chapters yet of Isaiah. He's just going to shift from judging other nations back onto God's people and some universal judgment stuff. So in case you were disappointed that we'd be moving on from judgment oracles, we still have a few weeks to go. In fact, I want to show you this chart just so you have a sense of where we're at. One of the elders actually emailed this to me, or texted it to me this week. You'll see that we're in chapters 1 through 39, which is, as we've said before, is like the Old Testament of Isaiah. It's the first two-thirds, and deals with the judgments of God against God's people, the nations, and all of these things. So we're sort of two-thirds of the way through this section. And then when we get to the fall, we'll be into sort of the redemption of that. So we're building a foundation for what we'll see when we get to the fall. And one other note about the judgment stuff, and this is as it pertains to Easter weekend. This is really important. We're actually going to skip ahead to chapters 34 and 35. And you'll see in this image here that the image on the left this image of sort of desolation and despair and complete emptiness and complete judgment is a visual representation of Isaiah chapter 34. So really encourage you to read that chapter ahead of time in anticipation of Good Friday. We'll have two services, 6 o'clock and 7:30. The picture on your right is filled with vibrant color and life and hope, and is a visual representation of Isaiah chapter 35. And we think that as you study those two chapters, you see a really clear picture of what happened when Christ went to the cross, on the one hand, what we'll look at on Good Friday, and what happened, what became possible for every one of us on Resurrection Sunday, represented in that other picture. So we're really excited. What that also means is that you'll get the, I think, by the Holy Spirit's power, you'll get the most impact if you're able to get to both Friday night and Sunday morning to sort of see that what we're calling the great reversal that takes place in what Jesus does. So really excited about Isaiah 34 and 35 and Easter weekend. This morning we complete the prophetic burdens to the nations. And as we do so, let's look to the Lord in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, as we sang this morning and worshiped you and then heard Jason's announcement, I couldn't help but be overly thankful and just really filled with gratitude for this community and for not only the generosity of this community, but that you are in fact moving and are in fact working. And Lord, would you not allow us, even this morning as we sit here, to be complacent or to fall back into some apathy, but that these sharp words of Isaiah would impact us as well, each one of us. Lord, we thank you for your word. Would you speak clearly to us by your Holy Spirit, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, chapter 21, we're just going to do a quick sort of oral overview, and then we'll jump into chapters 22 and 23. Chapter 21 begins with a second oracle in just 11 chapters against Babylon. It's kind of like Babylon 2.0. And it highlights a couple things. Number one, you'll note that as God moves along in his dealings with people, as they continue to respond in just resistance, rejection, rebellion, that these judgment oracles become more significant and more severe. It's not unlike how things would happen if you broke the law or if in your own parenting and so on and so forth, that God's response to people, and so this second oracle to Babylon specifically, is more harsh. Now, it's fair to ask the question, which Babylon is he talking about here? Is he talking about in his lifetime the impending threat of the Assyrians, whose capital city is Babylon? Or is he talking about 100 years later, the Neo-Babylonian Empire, the one we're familiar with Daniel and Nebuchadnezzar and so on and so forth? Or is he talking about the Babylon referenced in the book of Revelation, that sort of representative empire of the rebellion of mankind against God? Well, it's really all three. All three are in view here, and we could see in the text in particular that we'll look at in a little bit in chapter 22, some allusions to the immediate Assyrian threat and also some things related to the Neo-Babylonian Empire. And so John the Apostle quotes and talks from this passage as well, but the really important thing for us this morning from an application standpoint is Isaiah's response to the oracle that he hears. And I want to just read verse 4. For the sake of time, he says, "My heart falters. Fear makes me tremble. The twilight I longed for has become a horror to me." Now, this should probably remind you of Isaiah 15 and 16, 2 weeks ago, where we saw Isaiah weeping over the judgment against Moab. This is slightly different in that he's more horrified here at seeing the significance of this judgment. This is probably In the time zones that Isaiah writes in, he's probably thinking of the Medo-Persian Empire that God will use to judge the Babylonians. We see that in verse 9 and in verse 2a. But rather than splitting hairs, it's the attitude, it's the heart of Isaiah that moves us. It's a second reminder that we're not to gloat when God's enemies are judged. Here's God's prophet, and he's aghast. Remember Isaiah's attitude in Isaiah 6 when he's called. When he hears the message he's called to proclaim, his response is, "For how long, O Lord?" Similarly, as we heard several weeks ago, one of our special speakers remind us that when we share the gospel, it's either the smell of death or the fragrance of life. Some will love Christ in response to hearing the gospel message. Some will hate him. And that we are called to proclaim the gospel regardless. So Isaiah is depicted as watching and waiting for this judgment and having a right attitude. And certainly we want to hasten the justice of God. Make no mistake about it. We want those that have done wrong to be punished. We should be concerned about racism in our country as agents of God's justice. We should be concerned and involved where is appropriate with sex trafficking in our country and other issues of justice. But leaving how that all works out to the Lord, to the degree to which there's a ministry, and I don't know the name of it, of people who pray for the pimps of those involved in the sex trafficking industry. Why? Because if the pimps come to faith in Christ, that entire industry will crumble. That's the attitude of Isaiah here, certainly proclaiming God's justice, but also having a heart that breaks for God's for those that are rebellious to him. So that brings us to the latter half of the chapter. And there are two short oracles. We put them on your bulletin as the oracles against two sons. And the reason is that they're against Edom and Arabia. Edom, you may remember, is the descendant of Esau, Jacob's brother. And Arabia are the descendants of Ishmael, Abraham's other son. And so God pronounces these oracles against them, these judgment oracles. And remembering that Judah is the ultimate audience, the warning to Judah is not to make alliances with other nations who are ultimately against the judgment of God, even those who might be closely related to them. Even though this judgment is a year out, and even though these are close relations to the Israelites, they are to trust in God and in God alone. Now remember, they're under the threat, almost immediate threat of the Assyrian army, so there's this constant temptation to get people to help them. And God's saying, you need to get your house in order, chapters 1 through 12 of Isaiah, and trust and rely on me. Spoiler alert, we're going to see that God does, in fact, deliver Judah miraculously from Assyria in a couple weeks. But what's the application for us? I think it's really pretty simply that we need to be careful not to trust or rely on alliances, if you will, or other people beyond the Lord, even if it's family, even if there are extended family relationships, so on and so forth. And there are times where living out our Christian life will put us at odds with even our own family. And where will we anchor ourselves? That obviously puts a lot of different unique pressures when family is involved, isn't it? But we're to be faithful to the Lord and to trust in him. Well, that very quick overview brings us to chapter 22 and the oracle against the Valley of Vision. The Valley of Vision here is just sort of code language for the Kidron Valley and the surrounding area of Jerusalem. And this is an oracle against Jerusalem. And if you're sort of following along, it might give you pause to say, well, wait a minute, I thought this was the oracles against the nations and Jerusalem is coming later. For some reason, and we'll look at some hypotheticals this morning, in the midst of these oracles against these burdens for the nations, he takes a time out and he addresses the people of Jerusalem anyway. So chapter 22, we'll read several verses and then make our way through the chapter. Verse 1, an oracle concerning the Valley of Vision. And skipping to verse 5, the Lord Almighty has a day of tumult and trampling and terror in the Valley of Vision, a day of battering down walls and of crying out to the mountains. Elam takes up the quiver with her charioteers and horses. Kerr uncovers the shield. Your choicest valleys are full of chariots, and horsemen are posted at the city gates. The defenses of Judah are stripped away. And you looked in that day to the weapons in the palace of the forest. You saw that the city of David had many breaches in its defenses. You stored up water in the lower pool. You counted the buildings in Jerusalem. You tore down the houses to strengthen the wall. You built a reservoir between the two walls for the water of the old pool. But you did not look to the one who made it, or have regard for the one who planned it long ago. The Lord Almighty, called you on that day to weep and wail and tear out your hair and put on sackcloth. But see, there is joy and revelry, slaughtering of cattle and killing of sheep, eating of meat and drinking of wine. Let us eat and drink, you say, for tomorrow we die. So what is going on here in this chapter against the Valley of Vision or against Jerusalem? Well, first, and you'll note in your bulletin that it's really about the fact that Judah's and Jerusalem's people, their preparations are misapplied. Five times it talks about what the people of Jerusalem are doing to prepare for this siege, most likely by the Assyrians. And we know that from, if you're taking notes, the historical passages here are 2 Kings 18 to 20, and chapter 25, 2 Kings 18 to 20 and 25, and 2 Chronicles 32. And you'll see there that Hezekiah, as king, makes preparations for the impending siege of the Assyrians, including redirecting the water and tearing down houses on the walls of Jerusalem to fortify the walls. And so God's people are doing all these physical preparations in the city, but their hearts are out to lunch, and they're prideful in their own efforts, in their own ability to get over. And I think honestly, I think if you look in the text, you'll see they're actually kind of split. Some are prideful and not concerned. Others are just fatalists, and they turn to, and this brings us to our second bullet, they turn to this sort of attitude of just denial and partying. They're just like, you know, forget it. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. And by the way, that phrase, this is the first time in the scripture out of four times that we'll see that phrasing. Now, some of you may have thought that phrasing came from Dave Matthews Band, and that song in one of their first albums. It's actually a scriptural reference, and it's not a positive one, by the way. And it's Judah has gone, or Jerusalem has gone really beyond the pale here, and instead of repentance that God is calling for, there's revelry. Instead of piety, they're partying, and they're partying hard. They're not only in denial, but they're looking to all the wrong means of deliverance. By the way, I think that's part of why Isaiah deals with them here. It's almost as if, you know, if you've ever been at like the mall or something with your kids and you're interacting with somebody and you're deep in conversation, your kids act, and you're like, hold on a second, can I just address this issue? It's almost like that. I mean, he is revealing these prophecies against the nations, Babylon and Moab and Philistia and so on and so forth. Remember, these are oral traditions, and so he's also having ongoing relationship with the people of Jerusalem, and he has to reference and sort of deal with some of their issues and attitudes as well. So in the beginning of this, we're talking about the physical preparations of the city. The second half of the chapter talks about the false trust that they have in leaders who won't deliver. And in fact, the first leader, we won't read the text this morning, but is a leader named Shebna. And he kind of exemplifies this idea of denial and sort of partying. He goes so far as to, he's consumed with making sure that his tomb in burial is a burial and a tomb fit for a king. All he cares about is himself. He knows the city is going to be wiped out. And so God literally casts him out. He removes him, and he replaces him with this more pastoral, godly leader named Eliakim. So we read about Eliakim in verse 20 of chapter 22. It says, in that day, I will summon my servant Eliakim, son of Hilkiah. I will clothe him with your robe, that is the robe of Shebna, and fasten your sash around him and hand your authority over to him. He will be a father to those who live in Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. I will place on his shoulder the key to the house of David. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. I will drive him like a peg into a firm place. He will be a seat of honor for the house of his father. All the glory of his family will hang on him, its offspring and offshoots, all its lesser vessels from the bowls to all the jars. In that day, declares the Lord Almighty, the peg driven into a firm place will give way. It will be sheared off and will fall, and the load hanging on it will be cut down. The Lord has spoken. So God has decreed the removal of one leader and the beginning of another. And this leader is a good and honorable, almost pastoral leader of Judah and Jerusalem, who ultimately won't be able to withstand the pressures of the situation he's put in. Remember the reference to in that day. In the day of the Lord, he will ultimately fail. Now, there's another angle to this little passage. For those of you that are engineers in the room, this is proof that God loves engineers. Because here he gives us an engineering metaphor to help us understand how God relates. This idea of this peg driven into the wall that endures too much force and it shears off. So all of you that are engineers should be tuned in very much at this point. It's not a bad example either. Some of you may not know that I actually was an engineering student before I was in ministry. I ended up getting my associate's in electrical engineering, but I was very interested in civil engineering. And in high school, I read this book by Henry Petrosky. Maybe some of you have read it, To Engineer as Human. And fascinating little book, and amongst it, it covers some of the engineering failures, in particular in bridges over the last, you know, whatever amount of time. The most famous of which is probably the Tacoma Narrows Bridge, also known as Galloping Gertie. And this bridge, these are two pictures, one subsequent to the other, that was built with a single span. And when under any kind of wind, it would actually move, not by inches, but by feet. And one day in 1940, when there were 40-mile-an-hour sustained winds in the river valley, this bridge, acting like a wing, literally shook apart. It was destroyed. By the way, I think it's the Whitestone Bridge that is modeled in the same exact design, but it's 6 lanes long, and they had to completely reinforce the Whitestone Bridge so that this didn't happen to the Whitestone Bridge as well. Engineering failures. Just 2 weeks ago, there was this bridge in Miami, right, that had the state-of-the-art construction methods, but there were some engineering and probably even more likely inspection failures, and it fell. Well, here, Eliakim, he's a good leader. He's a leader God has put in place, and yet there's failure. You see, Eliakim can't deliver what Israel and what Judah ultimately needs. Eliakim foreshadows the coming of Christ, a ruler who will not fail, who fulfills the imagery of verse 22. And we know this because the Apostle John quotes Isaiah 22:22 in Revelation chapter 3. He says, "To the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open." Jesus is a better Eliakim. He is clothed with the garments of the king, with the father's authority, with the key to the house of David. Where Eliakim could not bear the load, and in the scripture there, it's really vivid. It says he hangs on him all of the load of his people and all the jars and vessels. It's image that he's just loaded down. And ultimately he fails, but Christ himself will bear all things. He will shoulder the load of his people, and specifically, the picture here is the load of their sin and not give way. Or will he? On Good Friday, we're going to make the case that it certainly looked like Jesus gave way, if you will, following the imagery of Eliakim. That when loaded down, this perfect picture of Christ, the Old Testament, being loaded with the sins and the weight of his people, he died. And it looked like all was lost. But oh, for the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus is a better Eliakim. By the way, the kids today in GBC are starting on the New Testament in the Gospel Project curriculum. And what's fascinating is they've spent all this time looking at the Old Testament. And you know what the curriculum basically is in the New Testament? Jesus is a better Moses. Jesus is a better Solomon. Jesus is a better David. And here we are this morning, Jesus is a better Eliakim. Now, from a practical standpoint, how do we apply this to our lives practically? It really has everything to do with leadership and not having the wrong trust in human leaders, be they political or pastoral. That's what's pictured in Shebna and in Eliakim. Now, I'm going to get political here for a second, and you don't have to squirm. I won't take sides here. But, you know, I don't know how you feel about our current president, whether you were voted for President Trump or you'd wished Hillary Clinton and got in, or you think things would have been better or worse. But isn't there this part of us that kind of thinks if we get the right person in office, like, things will kind of fall in line, things will get better? Or if you're not happy, you're like, well, maybe the next one, maybe the next, who's going to be the candidate in the next election? Now, I think it's incumbent upon us to participate in our form of government. But no one can deliver what we're really looking for except for Jesus Christ. Jesus is a better Eliakim, or fill in the blank, and our lives need to be anchored in that. So the warning to Israel, to Judah, is, again, where's your source of trust? Because good leaders, Eliakim, poor leaders, Shebna, they're all going to ultimately fail except for God himself, and because we have the vantage point of the New Testament, Jesus Christ himself. Again, the Lord wants to transform us as a community into kingdom-expanding, disciple-making, joy-filled servants of Jesus Christ. And so I want to ask you this morning, the first step in all that is, have I trusted Jesus as my Savior? You see, he's the only one that can live up to our expectations. Anybody else is a counterfeit God. Please do not ever make the mistake of putting myself or anyone else on this platform on a pedestal. You know, Billy Graham was recently called America's pastor. Franklin Graham was the one who said, my father would blush at that idea. Why? Because there's only one reverend, and that's Jesus Christ. Well, this brings us to the final oracle against the nations, and it's an oracle against the city of Tyre, marketplace of the nations and the bestower of crowns. And this highlights a major distraction that I think is very relevant for God's people today, for each one of us. It's a, if you will, a counterfeit God. And by the way, in his little book, Counterfeit Gods, Tim Keller addresses this particular area specifically. It's the area of materialism and money and assets and how that's a counterfeit God. And when we think about the city of Tyre, if you don't know much about this city, it was founded by those who had left the mother city of Sidon and planted this city, and it became this huge center for commerce and for trade. Her reach extended all the way to Spain and Africa and Egypt and certainly the entire land of Palestine, ancient Palestine at the time. And Tyre had long since left the ways of farming and more primitive things. It was really a trade hub for that entire area. And so much so, as we'll see in the text in just a minute, that the merchants of Tyre became as wealthy as, they basically became royalty. That's what happened in her prosperity. Now, from Judah's perspective, we know that from Ezekiel chapter 26, Tyre was in fact an enemy of Judah and Jerusalem. So that's probably why she's listed here. But it also seems that God has a genuine concern for the idolatry that we see in this city. So without belaboring, let's look at the text. Chapter 23, verse 1 says, an oracle concerning Tyre. Wail, O ships of Tarshish, for Tyre is destroyed and left without house or harbor. From the land of Cyprus, word has come to them. Be silent, you people of the island and you merchants of Sidon, whom the seafarers have enriched. On the great waters came the grain of the Sihor, the harvest of the Nile was the revenue of Tyre, and she became the marketplace of the nations. Be ashamed, O Sidon, and you, fortress of the sea, for the sea has spoken. I have neither been in labor nor given birth. I have neither reared sons nor brought up daughters. When the word comes to Egypt, they will be in anguish at the report from Tyre. Cross over to Tarshish. Wail, you people of the island. Is this your city of revelry, the old, old city, whose feet have taken her to settle in far-off lands? Who planned this against Tyre, the bestower of crowns, whose merchants are princes, whose traders are renowned in the earth? The Lord Almighty planned it, to bring low the pride of all glory, to humble all who are renowned on the earth. And then skipping to verse 17, at the end of 70 years, the Lord will deal with Tyre, and she will return to her hire as a prostitute and will ply her trade with all the kingdoms on the face of the earth. See, the expansion of the prosperity of the Phoenician city of Sidon was the city of Tyre. In other words, as a really lousy illustration, Tyre's kind of like the storage unit of Sidon, or better said, maybe, she's like the summer home in Watch Hill. It's the excesses of the prosperity of Sidon kind of lived out, or it's Jesus' bigger barns in his parable in the Gospel of Matthew, or in some ways it's kind of like what America was early on. America represented the excesses of Europe, but also became the source of the excesses of Europe for a season. I know that's really deep, but hang with me here. And this brings us back to the title of the message this morning, the root and the result. In a very real way, it says right in the text that the issue for Tyre was pride. And the result of her pride was material prosperity. But from a practical standpoint, it might actually be the opposite, that her success in commerce and in trade led to a place of pride in herself as a city. But regardless, the Lord's principal concern here and the lesson for his people Judah as the primary audience is to learn this lesson of pride and materialism, this root and this result. So we see in verse 17 that God is going to judge the city of Tyre, but after about 70 years, they're going to come back to this place of prominence, probably during the Medo-Persian Empire when Babylon is finally wiped out. But then, subsequent to that, Alexander the Great and the Greeks really, from the rest of human history, this city has never been what it was since then. And it's interesting that there seems to be, again, some concern and care from God for this city, because it's, most scholars think that the 70 years is the same exact time that the people of Judah and Jerusalem are exiled to Babylon as well. But what's the lesson for us? So what, right? Well, how do we apply this ancient text, and what does God have for us in that? The question is, does material prosperity make me confident in me? Does it give me a sense of pride? Or on the opposite, does sinful pride lead me to pursue material prosperity for a sense of security, retail therapy, right? You see, Tyre's God was her money, her prowess was her trade, and the security that those things brought. And for some of us, that's our deal too. We find great security in our things, either in assets or in accounts or our, literally our securities or retirement funding. But God wants to use our finances even for his kingdom purposes. That doesn't have to be just about this church. There's all kinds of things that the Lord is doing in his kingdom. But if God wants to transform us into kingdom expanding, disciple making, joy-filled servants of Jesus Christ, we have to look at even our material prosperity as well. Now, some of us, you know, perhaps you really struggle with gossip, or perhaps it's lust, and materialism isn't a struggle. But for others, it's the opposite. This is a major area of struggle. And you know, Billy Graham said that the scourge of America was materialism. I would argue that there are two, maybe three, possible sort of accepted sins in the church. And it's materialism, gluttony, and then depending on what circle you're in, maybe even gossip. And so if God's going to do something in us, what are the issues that Isaiah is dealing with? They're no different than the issues of our time. So it's been good for me to this week to sort of rethink again about these things. I want to ask Johnny and the band to come out, and we're going to sing the song we sang last week, relooking at those Old Testament ideas of how God moved and asking him to continue to do that. After we sing this song, I want to give you an opportunity. I'm going to ask you for an opportunity to respond to what you've heard this morning in two areas. One, there are some of you here, I'm convinced, that have never trusted in Jesus Christ alone for your salvation. You've never understood that the cross of Christ was God himself bearing your sin in himself, being the most complete, the better Eliakim or whatever leader you would put in that place. Maybe you've trusted in yourself, like Judah, preparing the walls and doing everything she can do to prepare for war. Maybe you've trusted in other leaders, be they political or pastoral, whatever category. But have you ever trusted Jesus Christ alone for your salvation? So I want to give you an opportunity to do that after we sing this song. And then for those of us that have are walking with Christ, to just take a moment and reflexively think about our engagement with our stuff, which ultimately comes from him anyway. And if that's something you need to recenter, to just take a moment and to just say, Lord, that's something I need to give to you. So let's sing this song, and then we'll wrap things up.